$1,000 for college.
Danny, you all set? Okay. Welcome everyone to the open hearing for the fiscal year 22 tax levy. I move to open the public hearing for the 2022 tax levy.
Second.
Roll call.
Okay. Motion by Schultz and second by
Drake.
Drake, thank you. Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes, motion carries.
Thank you.
The next agenda item is the public hearing to receive comments on the 2022 tax levy. Anyone who wishes to be heard will have the opportunity to present written or oral testimony. At this moment, are you presenting the, or?
So I'll go through the timetable of everything for everybody once again.
This started back on October the 25th. We did the presentation of the tentative estimated aggregate tax levy. We also went through the presentation of the tax levy itself, and the board approved at that time the resolution estimating the aggregate tax levy. On November 2nd, we post the notice of hearing and the in the paper, and tonight is the November the 15th, the public hearing to adopt the 2022 tax levy. So going through, here's the list of the levy breakdown requests by fund. As you can see, the educational fund, $50 million, operations and maintenance, 9.25, transportation at $3 million, working cash at $50,000, municipal retirement at $750,000, social security at $750,000, zero for fire and prevention and safety, $675,000 for tort, special education at $500,000, and $500,000 for leasing. As you know, the 22 tax levy here is based on the prior year's December CPI. So if you end up going back, you could see our limit is 5%. Okay, the tax extensions for non-bond and interest funds will increase. Right now, this is estimated at $18.53 million. The tax extensions for the bonds will actually decrease by $66,000. The total tax increase right now is at $18.49 million. This is an appropriation, approximate amount of 35.24% increase. So estimated to the taxpayers right now in a $300,000 home, non-bond and interest is approximately $840 versus prior year. The change in bond and interest is a dollar from the prior year. Therefore, the annual increase, if you add the two of them together, would be $839. However, we are capped by the CPI plus any new growth. With that being said, with a 5% increase, it would equate to approximately $15.7 million. Therefore, on a $300,000 home, it'd be about approximately $710. How it differs from prior years, we have within this year's levy, the 60-cent referendum, the CPI of also 5% and new growth at $600,000, and then kind of a levy redistribution, providing a little bit more for buildings and grounds to take care of some deferred maintenance that the district has. Here's the copy of the tax certificate, requesting from the county what we will be levying. And then per the new guidelines that came out, we need to go through the current balances as of the latest date, which would be 10/31. So as you can see here, here are the current balances that the district has, 13.5 mil in education, 1.1 in leasing, 9.1 in operations and maintenance, debt service at 3.4, transportation at 4 million, IMRF Social Security at 2.2, capital outlay 193,000, working cash at 20 million, tort at 862,000, and $0 for fire prevention and safety. Any questions? Yes.
I think I know the answer, but why zero for fire safety and prevention?
We are not levying for that because we end up taking most of it through health, life, safety, which we need to identify and then go out for it. So, you're welcome. Any other questions? Thank you.
Are there any additional questions or comments from the Board of Education? Ms. Love, have we received any written record or testimony concerning the 2022 tax levy?
I have not received anything.
Okay. Is there any members of the public here that would like to give oral testimony or comments regarding the 2022 tax levy? Not all persons desiring to be heard have been given the opportunity to present written or oral testimony with respect to the 2022 tax levy. This 2022 tax levy has been placed on tonight's agenda, the November 15th, 2022 regular Board of Education meeting, as an action item. If we can get a motion to adjourn this meeting. Move to close the public hearing for the 2022 tax levy.
Second.
Roll call.
Motion by Schultz and second by Anderson.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes, motion carries.
Thank you, everyone.
Now we'll move into open session. If we could all stand and recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Next up is approval of the agenda. Do we have any changes to tonight's agenda?
I do not.
If not, I move to approve the agenda.
Second.
Roll call.
Motion by Schultz and second by Anderson.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes, motion carries.
Thank you, everyone. Next up on the agenda are recognitions from the crowd here tonight. A whole bunch of them, which is fantastic.
Not. So let's see. First, we can get, do we have, let's see, is there anybody here from the girls' cross-country team? Coming up. Okay, and is Cole here too? Cole, come on out. Why don't you come up? Can the two of you just introduce yourself and tell us how you did at state this year? There's a mic up there. If you could talk to the mic, then the people that, there's like thousands of people watching us on YouTube right now. So.
Hello, I'm Mia Pasha. I'm a senior, and this was my third year at state, and I placed 17th. I actually did not get fifth place. That would be from last year. But I placed 17th.
Hi, I'm Cole Cather. I've qualified for state three times and ran there twice. This year I placed 91st out of 234. And it's about 50 places better than where I placed last year.
The two of you, thank you for coming tonight, and we've got some certificates here. We'll give those to your coaches just from the Board of Education. We also just wanted to recognize that the girls cross country team were IHSA regional champs, so we're excited about that this year. Let's see, do we have golfers? We got some people from the boys golf team. You want to come up? And I think they've got a coach here tonight that can introduce them.
All right, good evening, everyone. The boys' golf team had the best season in school history. Just a quick note, so we were third at regionals, which means we got the entire team to move on to sectionals. So that's only the third time in school history that that's happened. And then at sectionals, we were also third place, so the whole team got to move to state, and that was the first time in school history. So definitely the best we've ever done, and we're very proud to share that with the girls' team as well, for them to do that the first time. So just going to speak about each guy just for 5 seconds each. So Cam Simmons is a sophomore. So step up, there you go. Cam's personal best was a 76 at regionals, and he also had a 77 at sectionals. Adam Juarez is a junior. His personal best was an 80 at the Warren Invite. He also had the best score for our team against Lake Forest Academy. Vaughn Hartnig is a senior. Vaughn had a 77 at regionals. His personal best was at sectionals, a 74. Wow. Right. Alex Welder. Alex is a senior. He had a 76 at regionals. His personal best came at sectionals, a 73. And finally, we have Nick Steinhober. He's a senior. He was a four-year member of our varsity. He had a 75 at regionals, which was the best score there, 79 sectionals, and he had our team's best score at state. So good job, Nick. So. All right. Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.
One question. Any of you guys fielding anything
from the LIV tour? anything going on there? Okay.
Question for you, Coach. Yeah. Where do you guys practice?
Bittersweet.
Okay.
So right down the street.
Yeah. Nice.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Of course,
that's a nice course. I haven't golfed in a long time, but that's a real nice course.
I'm Leanne Boncher, coach of the girls' golf team. Super excited to speak to you tonight about their accomplishments this year. I wanted to highlight some of the most exciting things that they did. They started out the season red hot, and they shot the best score in school history at a 341 at Shepherd's Crook. Just to give you a reference, that's a score of 83, 84, 84, and 90 for 18 holes. All three of these ladies were part of that. They went on to compile a 7-2 season record. They placed second in the conference tournament, which is our highest ever. They were back-to-back regional champions, so this was our second time winning regionals, so that was really thrilling. And then at the sectional tournament, they placed third to advance as a team to state, our first time ever doing that as a team. Extremely proud of these athletes. Here with me tonight is senior Elena Gaden. She led us in almost every 18-hole match this season, especially through the state series, and she was our one golfer who made the cut to play the second day at state, which was phenomenal. Elena. Also with us is senior Mia Kaznati. Mia did amazing this year, and she led us in a lot of 18-hole tournaments as well, and very consistent, and someone we really relied on throughout the season, and she came in with some top scores to kind of pull us through some close matches. So congratulations, Mia. And then sophomore Jordan Dodd is also here. She did an amazing job for us as well. As a sophomore, she played in some varsity matches this year. We had 8 girls who played, 6 who went downstate. And so it was a real competitive season even amongst the girls themselves. And so just super proud of them.
Game. I was feeling better about my golf game when we were announcing the scores, and I was thinking 9 holes, and then you said 18 holes, and then my confidence just went really far down. All right, we're really, really proud of our students. I think on behalf of the board, I can say that we're really proud of you. Appreciate you not only giving your best, but representing the school district throughout the season and every place you went. We've got a short video here also to recognize our letter of intent signees. We put this out on social media this week, but I think traditionally do we go ahead and play this during the board meeting so we can see that? Okay.
Somebody better tell them why they're here. They just may run away from you. fighting, but don't look down.
'Cause I'm on top of the world, eh? I'm on top of the world, eh? Waiting on this for a while now. Paying my dues to the dirt. I've been waiting to smile, eh? Now holding it in for a while, eh? Take you with me if I can. Been dreaming of this since a child. I'm on top of the world.
I've tried to cut these corners.
Okay, let's see. I think we've got one other recognition in here. Again, thanks to our students. We assume you have lots of homework tonight, so if you want to head out anytime, that's cool. We also want to quickly recognize that it's National Board Member Appreciation Day, School Board Member Appreciation Day. So from the community, we appreciate the effort that our board members put into the work that they're doing. So thank you very much.
Isn't National Bun Cake Day today, too, did I hear?
Yeah, he's busy cooking bun cakes.
Yeah. Next up on the agenda is the time for public comment. Visitors are allowed up to 3 minutes to address the Board of Education. Jean, I didn't check. Did anybody sign in ahead of time?
No.
What's that?
Okay,
but does not prevent anyone from addressing the board if they have a comment or anything they would like to address us? Anyone?
Can I? Come on, Beth.
No, you cannot.
Stay seated, Beth.
Moving along. The president's report. All I really wanted to talk about is the conference this weekend. I'd encourage all the board members to make sure you go through the app and all the tools that are online. Thank you, Danny, for sending out some abbreviated things on topics like finance and bargaining. But go and register for the events. The app is very helpful. I know in the past we've spent some time to talk together as a group to make sure that we're all seeing as many different things as possible. My train of thought of this year is go see whatever you want to see. So if there's two people at the same meeting, I'm okay with that because it can bring up discussions, comments about what you saw at the meeting. So if you find that somebody else has a schedule similar to yours, that's absolutely okay. But there's a lot of good activities to see.
Sounds good.
Okay.
We can talk about the resolutions one more time if anybody has any more comments. Does anybody have any more comments about the resolution? I already know yours, Tony. I got you. Okay. Danny put a recommendation in, which sounds good. Okay. All right. Then I know what to do. Thank you.
Okay. That being said, we'll probably all see each other Thursday night or at some point on Friday. Next up, we have committee reports. The first and only committee report is the Insurance Committee.
Yeah, we don't have anything to add to the minutes in there unless anybody has questions.
To the superintendent's report.
Let's see, I don't have anything to add to my written report that's there in 9A. If there are any questions on that, the Veterans Day activities or the monthly reports, we can address those now. Otherwise, I'd turn the floor over to Mr. Geocaris to talk about E-rate briefly.
So we're coming into the start of year 26. Year 26 is next fiscal year. So E-Rate talks about years in terms of when the program began. So it's the 26th overall year of the E-Rate program. Some things due to Dr. Engel's work last year with direct certifying and getting a more accurate picture of where our free and reduced income or low income population is at. We, in the past, we had been a 40% reimbursement school district through the E-Rate program. We filed an application to be a 60% reimbursement. So depending on where our free and reduced numbers kind of lie at the in the spring, we expect either to get a 60% reimbursement through E-Rate in the future or a 50% reimbursement through E-Rate. So either way, we should see an increase in the money. When we spend money, they'll reimburse us a higher percentage of that. So the big news for us next year is the state of Illinois has had a broadband network, the Illinois Century Network, or the ICN. In the past, it's been available. It's usually been more for some of like the downstate schools to provide high-speed internet to those downstate schools. But they've expanded up here. They are filing on behalf of districts in Illinois to provide free internet. So we signed up for that program last year. So this year we are in the queue now for year 26. So what that means for our district is beginning next year in 23-24, we will be moving our primary internet services over to the ICN, which means we will have free internet for the school. So that represents a $6,900 per month savings to the district. What we will do is we will keep a one gig connection with Comcast as a backup, just in case. So if we lose our ICN network, we'll have some of our key network services that require internet, things like email, PowerSchool, things like that. We'll have assigned under a one gig standalone service to go out. So we'll still have some small internet costs, but like I said, we're gonna go from a 3 gig connection to each campus that we're spending $6,900 a month for to 4 gigs at each campus that we will spend $0 a month on. So that's great news.
Something coming from the state.
Right? It's fantastic. The other thing, Category 2, last year was a big year for us for Category 2. If you recall, we did a major fiber optic cabling project. We updated our Wi-Fi systems. We did some firewall work. We had a lot of Category 2 projects around this time last year, all of our servers and IDFs throughout the district. So this year, we don't really have any Category 2 projects. That's like where you buy, use E-Rate to purchase hardware, infra, back network backbone, cabling, things like that. This is because right now we're in the middle of our cycle. So this is year 3 of 5, and we have about $100,000 of our E-Rate budget left. So we're holding on to that. We don't anticipate a lot of needs over the next couple of years, but we have things like video servers that are starting to get up there. So we're kind of holding on to that $100,000 to year 4, year 5, just to see if we have something that pops up. But we know we don't have any needs right now for next year that would we feel good about using E-Rate funding for. So that's E-Rate. Any questions? Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Joe.
Turn a few minutes over to Dr. Keeley to just give us our annual update on the student services department.
Okay, so student services, I'm going to focus more on the traditional student services because athletics falls under me, but they do their own report. Special ed falls under student services, but they do their own report. And our post-secondary counselors also did their own report for you. So this will focus on everyone else in the department. So for our focus areas this year, our panorama surveys, and I'll go more in detail as we go through this presentation, our SST procedures, our SST teams using that panorama software, our Resilient Wednesdays, which is a professional development we're providing staff this year, our AIM program and how we're assessing that this year, enhancing reviewing our security procedures, and the Ken Trump security audit. Just as a reminder, you probably know this, this is our staffing, pretty consistent on both sides of town. The only difference being is we were unable to fill the one AIM social work position. We did post that rather late. It's pretty competitive this year, especially with ESSER funding. A lot of schools were using those funds for social workers. And a psychologist was a last minute resignation as well. So we weren't able to fill that, but we are outsourcing that. So we do get those psychological services from a company, but it's not someone on staff. Our student service team, just so you understand, I'll refer to these SSTs a lot. I just wanted to define that for you if you don't know what that is. These are the teams that work to address academics, attendance, and social emotional growth or development of our kids. And essentially, we have three SST teams per building. They're under the deans. Deans lead those teams. So there's one dean, and they have an alpha slice. And inside that alpha slice, there's two counselors, a social worker, and a psych travels between all three teams. So those are our three intervention teams, which we refer to as SST, and they exist at both buildings. Panorama, we're very fortunate. Panorama, we got late last year with ESSER funding. We're really excited about this software. It's really twofold. It's a survey software where we can survey our students very easily and efficiently, and it's based on national benchmarks. And it also is a software that allows our student service teams to kind of see the whole child, which you'll see in a minute. We do the surveys twice a year in the fall. We just did one, I don't know, maybe it was a month and a half ago or so, and we'll do it again in the spring. It's the same survey. So we're able to track our students, see how they're responding to things over the year. Again, the survey is intended to address and track that SEL growth of our students. The survey, again, which is important, it uses national benchmarks, so we're able to compare our kids, our age group kids, against kids across the country to see how they're responding in order to identify trends not only here, but identify our trends based off of national trends. Again, yes.
Does everybody get the survey?
Yeah, everyone gets a survey. The software, the key component of that is integrates with PowerSchool. So every night there's an upload in the Panorama. So what our SST teams are doing is they're looking, they used to look just at PowerSchool, and it was very difficult, more robust to kind of look through and more challenging to look through to identify kids, put kids into groups. Panorama takes the information from PowerSchool and includes those things in an easy to use software for what we're looking for, which is intervening with kids. So we're really excited about Panorama. It also allows those survey results also allow us to have deeper conversation with parents. So when students are, you know, are in need of interventions, they're struggling, we're seeing all of a sudden downslide in grades or behavior, we're able to use that survey data and over time too as well to kind of target what how our kids responded to these typical questions. And is a great use of time with our parents to actually diagnose some of those issues that are going on. So here's what the data looks like when we get it from Panorama. This is just a district slide. It's kind of an overview. On the left, you'll see the topics. So there's actually two slides of this, and these are the social emotional learning targets that we have, we're focused on. And then the next column is the percent favorable. There's five responses, two negative responses, one neutral response, which is counted as a negative, and then two positive responses. So that's how they, when they say percent favorable in the second column, that's what that means. Those are favorable responses. And then the next column, which is again important to us to kind of look at us and how we're doing nationally, you can see where we're landing in those percentiles. Green is good, red is not so good. So we want to see as many greens as we can. And because we're tracking it over time, the last column, you can see our plus and minus compared to the survey we did in the spring, compared to the survey we did in the fall. Are we seeing increases in those areas? Obviously, coming off COVID, this is of great interest to us. And this is just the other areas, the four additional areas, same schematic. Topics on the left, percentage of favorable responses are in the next column, percentile, and then increase or decrease from the previous survey. And then this is just a cohort. If you look at the cohorts by grade, obviously 2026 is our freshmen, 2023 is our seniors. The green are you have the average up top of all respondents, those that number band going across for each of those areas. And then they broke it down by cohort. Are they plus or minus over the average? And obviously when the kids become seniors, they're at their highest scores. That's how it should be if we're doing our job right, which hopefully we are and we continue to do so. So that's Panorama. Again, we want to thank the board and for allowing us to use ESSER funds. That's an extremely powerful tool that we've just started using, that we're starting to get really good at, our student service teams, and we're hoping to roll that out to teachers next year. Resilient Wednesdays last year, this is the professional development, must being on late starts. When kids come into our lates, we provide professional development to our staff. The student service teams have provided that professional development and also outsourced a little bit of it. And these are just some of the topics that we focused on last year, and then we continue to focus on this year. That multi-tiered system of supports, MTSS, that's our student service teams. They're making sure that we are diagnostically and have an organizational behind how we're intervening with kids, how are we putting kids that are getting tier one interventions, how are we moving up tier two if the tier one isn't working, and then eventually a tier three intervention. Okay. The AIM program is another, I think this has been of interest to the board in the past. We continued AIM program again this year. Again, the overall goal is just to provide foundational skills to students to be successful in their coursework, also their interpersonal relationships, and their post-secondary pursuits. So the AIM program is at both campuses. There's two teachers at both campuses, or four altogether. There's a social worker at both campuses. So there's 10 sections that take place at both campuses. What do? They support students who are not at grade level, who gets placed into an AIM class, or they're not on track for graduation, one or the other. There's direct instruction on social emotional executive functioning skills, because that's usually why they're not on track or they've fallen behind. And then there's also online credit recovery available to those students inside those programs, so they're able to reclaim some of that credit that they may have failed in the past. The data has been very good. I'm really excited to see what the data is this year. For the Almond side, just as far as just number of students, we're able to get more students into this section than we were in the past with two teachers. It gave us more space to place kids in those courses. And with that, they completed more retread credit. So in the past, only about 1.7 was the average. Last year, our AIM students completed 2.2 classes per semester, which again gets them back on track for graduation or gets them back on grade level, which is critically important. At Eau Plaine, the side effect of this as well, this is what I'm really excited about, was the secondary effects. Not only were their students obviously reclaiming that credit, but they were failing less classes of their other classes that they had. And that was, again, tied to the executive functioning and social-emotional learning targets that we were targeting with those students. So that, to me, was the most important. We didn't even see that coming. We thought, oh, maybe that'll happen. We definitely have excellent data on that. I'm hoping that replicates itself this year. Hopefully that is the same, but we'll see as time goes. And then the bottom, it'll show you the exact number of courses and how many failures and how we reduce those failures over all their courses.
Pat, if I could just ask a quick question.
Sure.
On AIM specifically, do you think that based on the resources that we have been provided this program, that we're servicing all the students that need this kind of help at this moment?
I feel pretty good about it. Where I think it'll level off is at Eau Plaine. And because Eau Plaine, when they're freshmen, we don't know what we don't know about them. So we don't really have to intervene with them. Earliest is second semester, certainly sophomore year. Where at Almond, it's 2 years of kids. So that staffing levels is definitely appropriate at Almond. To be determined at Eau Plaine, we're going to see what those numbers look like at the end of this semester and then the following semester.
One more question. The slices at each campus, you said you have three slices?
Yes.
It has two deans?
Three deans. Each dean has an alpha slice. So, like Nate Karasak has A through H.
Dean, two counselors, a psychologist?
And a social worker.
And a social worker.
The psych is a part of all three teams.
Yeah, the psych goes across all three.
That's correct.
That's a problem.
It is. Okay. That is a challenge. How many counselors?
No.
Okay.
So how many kids are then in each slice? Six?
You could say 600.
600, okay.
It's a big number.
Yeah, too big.
And that's the transition. Remember, what our deans are, we're trying to push our deans to be more student service based, but they still have to do the discipline.
Right, of course.
I mean, that's never going to go away. Right. And that's the balancing act they tried to kind of balance with, and that's where the psychologist is extremely helpful to the deans, where they're helping lead those intervention conversations so the dean can balance some of their time.
So more staff in that those programs would be helpful for increasing student achievement?
Based on the data that we see from our programs, that is correct.
I have a quick question.
Yes.
You said that at Eau Plaine campus, it's hard to identify the freshmen because we don't have a lot of data on them coming in and usually take second semester to sophomore year. Is there any coordination with the feeder schools to identify those students coming in freshman year so we can give them help from day one instead of waiting till we have experience with them?
There is, and we do. And we do have programs that come from the feeder school that are identified.
Okay.
I'm talking about the larger numbers in AIM, because we just won't have that till the kid finishes their first semester. How many classes did they fail, if any? You know, that's what I was referring to. We definitely have programs for kids that are identified by the junior high. Michelle Bertola's worked very hard at those relationships, and we have those kids identified. There's even a summer school program to get them to bridge before they get to us.
Fantastic.
Yes.
I'm a little nervous about the term identify.
Identify kids that are at risk?
How do you select or select an...
For the AIM program?
I know obviously nothing about this, so help me out.
Okay.
How do you pick what students get enrolled in these programs?
Students who have failed multiple courses.
Okay.
Students that have had a tier one interventions and it's not being effective, and we need a tier two intervention, which is more of an intensive intervention. So that's how those students are identified. Sometimes it's attendance issues, sometimes it's behavior. Grades usually is the first level that we see. If a kid's failed multiple classes, we got to get them back on track for their grade level or back on track for graduation.
Truancy, detention?
All those things happen still. But then here in these classes, if you're talking about the kids that were identified for this program, they're also getting that other layer of support where there's a social worker and a teacher in that classroom. So you have two people, and they're tailoring their lessons to address some of those behaviors and hopefully helping those kids grow in those areas so we can stop that behavior from happening.
If I can dig into this for a second, what John brought up, you have 600 kids in each group, and you have how many people? How much help would the average kid get? One out of 600 with four people to help them out.
That's very challenging overall, but remember, when you're talking about a tier two intervention, it drops to about 15 to 20% of the population of any given grade level. And a tier three, which is
50.
Right, it starts to drop that number of kids who need that level of support, but it still is a challenge. There's no question. And that's why we're trying this panorama software. We're trying to survey. We're trying to be able to collect that data more efficiently so that we can identify and stop missing kids. But it is a challenge. There is no question about it. When a dean's SST is, 600 kids, give or take, it's challenging work to make sure we're getting every kid and not letting a kid slip through the cracks. Moving on to security, any other questions about AIM or student services? Okay. Security procedures, again, this year, one of the things from Ken Trump's last visit was our relocation planning. He did strongly recommend we kind of strengthen that and change and modify some things. That was something that was in the works, and then COVID happened, so it kind of fell off. So we have finalized that. I feel like we're in really good shape. I'm looking forward for him to come back to look at the work that we have completed in that area. I've been very fortunate. Again, I continue to have a great partnership with Gurnee PD. I'm even going to professional development with them, and that's always interesting, and it's nice to sit down and have time to talk to them and listen to them when we're in the PD with them. There is also a lot of online free PD that we've been able to leverage, and even deans, which is, it's very hard for deans to get to professional development, but some of this online stuff where they can break away for an hour and watch a webinar on something and a timely topic. So that's been helpful. And I think, again, in this day and age, it's just become a priority for schools. And there's a lot more opportunity for us to get some PD quick hitters that are efficient and effective and are helping us grow. Our emergency testing notification system, we're testing that more often. We're not waiting to just those two times a year when we're doing lockdowns. We just tested on both sides of town, I don't know, last week or the week before, just making sure that those are operational and working correctly. We're collaborating. I'm collaborating with Mr. Giocaris to select a new vendor for our FOB system, camera upgrades, and then potential expansion of those emergency notification systems. In October, our Institute Day was focused on safety. I presented to staff along with the Gurnee Police Department presented to staff, and then we had breakout sections that were focused on our safety plan. And that was, I think, a very effective day, and I think people enjoyed it. We're gonna host again in March. We partner with the ROE. They have to be the countywide safety conference here at the Allman campus. So it's an institute day for our teachers. They'll all be at Eau Plaine, and then I'll be over here, and the student service staff typically will come over here too to take advantage of this safety conference in March, which is, again, a really great experience. It's free, and Mike Carner's done a nice job getting that going for us. March. What's our institute day in March? March 4th, June?
March 7th.
I don't know. First week of March?
I think think it's March 7th.
Yes. And that's a really good con. They bring in good speakers. There's vendors here. It's a good show. And then finally, Ken Trump visit. We're looking forward to getting with him and making sure we finalize those dates. And then he'll obviously have opportunities for growth for us based on what he sees and how he reviews our plans and what has happened or what's changed. So we look forward to that opportunity for growth.
March 6th is today.
6th. Okay, that's it. Any other questions for me?
Thank you very much. Okay.
Nice job, Pat.
Next up is the consent agenda. Any changes to the consent agenda? If not, I move to approve the consent agenda items, which include personnel recommendations per Exhibit A, numbers 77 through 80, as posted. There are no Exhibit B personnel recommendations at this time. The payment of the bills dated November 15, 2022, in the amount of $4,858,726.85. Regular meeting minutes and executive session minutes of the October 25, 2022. The donation of material goods to the Manitow Creek Watershed Alliance, as presented in the serious safety hazards and temporary serious safety hazards for the 2022-2023 school year as presented.
Second.
Roll call.
Motion by Schultz and second
by Anderson. Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
6 yes. Motion carries.
Thank you. Next up are some discussion items, starting with a school report card.
Just summarize, in addition, so I included for the board a handful of areas we're celebrating and where we can get better that's in the board packet. But I mentioned that there was some new data around career and tech education. I'm just going to take a couple minutes and go through that because that's new. So traditionally, when we're looking at the school report card, we're looking at things like attendance, SAT results. We're looking at how many of our students are enrolling in college, how many have to take remedial courses in college, our teacher retention rate. Those have been longstanding data points in the school report card. The state's putting more and more emphasis on career and technical education. And some of the philosophy or idea behind this is that students should be given more than just opportunities to experience career and technical education. They should, those experiences should count for something after they leave high school. So the term stackable credentials is a term that we use a lot of time now when we're talking about CTE classes. And the idea is, are they getting some type of credential right now that they can actually build upon after they leave high school? And whatever they get after they leave high school, does that allow them to continue to grow? So we want to make sure that we don't pigeonhole anybody into one area or decision, but that, you know, whatever they're doing here actually counts for credit. So the state has identified students as what they're calling CTE concentrators. So CTE is career and technical education, and a concentrator is a student that's taken two courses in a career interest area beyond the introductory course. So maybe I take introduction to accounting, but then maybe after that I take accounting one and accounting two. Because I took the accounting one and accounting two, that makes me a concentrator. So as they report data in the coming years, it looks like the data they're gonna be reporting is, hey, based on the number of students that were into a career pathway or a sequence of courses more than just an exploratory, how are those students doing? Generally, our graduation rate for those students is pretty high. So we've got a high 100% graduation rate here in the district. Students that are concentrators, their reading level is around the 42%. 42% of them are meeting or exceeding standards for reading, and about 38% are meeting or exceeding for math. There's an idea of a non-traditional enrolled student in CTE courses. So this is looking at students, typically female students or minority students who are traditionally underrepresented in CTE courses. The state's saying, hey, we want you to look at that, talk about that, think about that, try to make that number better. Let's see, and then there's a program quality that has to do with when they're going through our program, is it a credential that they can use afterwards? So are they going to get college credit for taking those courses? Is it a dual credit course? Is it an advanced placement course? And do they have some type of internship or work-based learning experience as part of their programming here at the high school? So those are some of the new metrics. It's very, very new because for, you know, as far back as I can, as far back as they've been doing the state report card, it's been very traditional reading, writing, arithmetic, SAT scores, attendance, teacher, you know, they haven't really changed around the metrics a whole lot. But this is a significant change and probably one that might warrant some discussion by the board. That's all I have for just kind of outlining the report card, but can I answer any other questions if you'd like?
Nope. Report card here, 11 points higher than the state average, 6 points higher than the state average, 10 points higher than the state average, that's fine. Is there a difference between suburban Chicago, inner city Chicago, and downstate? And if there is, how do we rank among our peers?
Yeah, there definitely is a difference. So the state, I can provide some more detailed information in the future, but generally the way that the state looks at that to compare yourself is that it allows you to choose on like a scattergram what other school districts have similar makeup, a similar student makeup or a similar funding makeup, and allows you to compare to them. So I could definitely get you some more information, get the whole board some more information on exactly how we did there.
Now we'll go on to the facilities projects.
Yeah, so I just want to, because we haven't done large scale, it's my impression is we haven't done a lot of large scale facility projects recently, but we are turning in a levy that allows us to do more of that. I'm just trying to make sure we're keeping everybody in the loop so that if you got any questions, you can ask those questions. So we're definitely moving forward on replacing some roofing areas at the Eau Plaine campus. Everybody seemed to think that was appropriate. We're going to get bids. When are we getting bids, Dr. Engel, on that?
Bids should be in next week, Monday.
So we'll bring those in December.
Yep.
To the school board. We definitely are going to work, plan on doing some brick and mortar or some tuck pointing at the Eau Plaine campus.
We will also have bids next week, Monday, on that.
Item number three on there is replacing the press box at the Eau Plaine campus. So the press box has been in there for some period of time. We've redone it kind of in-house in the past. Right now it has taken on enough water that there's some structural questions with the actual box itself. We had somebody come out and look at it. We're also concerned with the amount of water that's coming in if it rains or with the snow because of some of the electrical equipment in there. So we're looking at the cost of replacing that press box. A significant chunk of that is going to include taking the old press box down because the people that we've talked to that do press boxes, they're not interested in putting a new press box on the current structure that we have there. So it's not going to just be taking it off and putting a new one on. We're going to have to also talk through the structure that holds that press box up and replacing that. We won't move on that without your approval specifically, but we're going through that, and it's going to be a chunk of money. It would be more than $250,000 to replace that press box because of the structural things we got there holding it up.
I assume that the majority of these items, if not all of them, were on our 10-year health, life, safety from our architects and probably rated accordingly, or where do those items fit in with some of these items in the need?
Health, life, safety is just going to only address health, life, safety, not necessarily deferred maintenance on certain things. You know what I mean? So there's two different kind of ways of looking at it. You have the health, life, safety, and then you also have like a facilities need audit. This is kind of a little bit of both. You have exterior doors in there with health, life, safety that are definitely still need to be done. I believe those were all Category B.
Okay.
The Category A's have been done from the last one, correct. We are starting on the B's now, correct.
Okay. Yeah, because a lot of this stuff seems like it would have been identified as Category A or B that we would have to do anyway and levy for it and just do it. But we have, you're right. I was checking to see, we have other needs that may not show up on that. And then I genuinely was asking a question, how do we determine, like we have to do the ones in the 10-year plan, but how do these others get the priority then over those? I just didn't know how you were able to.
The good thing about like health, life, safety is that they have the ABC rankings, you know, yeah. A, immediate, B, you have some time, C, yeah. We'd like to get you know, get it done in 10 years. The other stuff, like, and if you look at a health, life, safety assessment, they're never going to touch the roof. They're not going to look at brick and mortar and tuck pointing.
Okay.
It's more building need, facility need.
Okay.
That's where HVAC is going to come into play. You'll see some, well, I take that back. I look at the corridor doors, that's health, life, safety there. Our fire alarm, health, life, safety is there. Renovating bathrooms, that's much more of a building facility need than a health, life, safety aspect of it.
I think 5, 6, and 7 were on the health, life, safety report.
And where are we in the 10 years?
Like, the last one that we had done was in 2017 by DLA.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So we're about halfway through the cycle, and we're starting on the Bs.
It might be worthwhile looking into just a facility needs audit. So what we did here is we're prioritizing the things that are broken and need to be fixed. And are broken significantly enough that it's possibly impairing the utilization of a often used facility. I think that's a fair question. And it is going to take us some work to get into a real method of prioritizing them because we haven't done anything in so long.
Right. And there's, right. I mean, we haven't done anything in a while. And then now 5 years in, we're only getting to the B's now. And that's going to take a chunk of money. And then we have liability in multiple ways, health, life, safety. But there's just general liability of when we have aging, like I would assume the box.
Press box.
Yeah, it's probably not going to show up on that. But there could be just a general liability and safety issue with that. So this was helpful to me. I don't need any more information.
Sure.
Helpful for me to understand how that all interplays with one another.
Might kind of talk through 4, 5, 6, and 7. 8 is something I'd like to talk through. So when I initially brought an example of a facility timeline, it included some HVAC work. Some of the feedback was, hey, are there possibly some of those units that we can refurbish? Do we really have to replace all of them? And so we are, I think last month I brought an example of a contract for an organization to come in and try to identify which of those units actually need that work. We're still soliciting some information from other vendors to see if there's a better price point for that. We'll eventually come with a proposal probably for an HVAC assessment. At the same time, Mike and I are talking through the possibility of doing a facility audit to help us with some of the prioritization outside of the health, life, safety plan that we got. In the meantime, so my recommendation on the HVAC is probably to pause on the HVAC work until we can do some of that that HVAC assessment. In the meantime, on the list of 0 to 3 in the next 0 to 3 years is our turf, our football field turf. The turf is ripped in a couple spots. We've been sewing it together. It works. We could allocate that for summer projects because we're pausing on HVAC work, for example, until we can get some more information on those. If we moved quickly, we could probably still get 2022 pricing through the purchasing cooperatives, but that might not be something that you're interested in. But if you'd like, we can go back and do some work on that and come in December. A field turf's going to cost us probably $750,000. Somewhere around there. Yeah. So it's not a nothing expense. It's used all day, every day, by everybody.
Weekends. Feeder programs. Yeah. Everybody uses that thing. I mean, to me, it needs to be done, whether it's this summer or next summer. I don't doesn't matter to me, but I think it definitely needs to be done.
How many years past its useful life is it?
3 years on borrowed time.
Is there a liability issue? Some kid's going to go to college scholarship and breaks his ankle and totally destroys himself on our turf. I mean, is there
potential? Yeah, most likely if the turf ripped enough that we didn't feel like we could repair it, we would just stop using it and then have to pause usage until we could get the turf either repaired or replaced at that point. Right now we've been able to sow it, and I don't know if there's a whole lot of liability there because kids are running around on grass and rocks and mud if we don't have a turf.
I think it needs to be done, but if we have room in the schedule and we're not going to be doing anything else, then I think, you know, it'd be worthwhile doing. But
yeah, I think that's the reason to talk through it, is if we're not going to do HVAC work, it opens up some capacity to do it now and the timeline. With the timeline,
HVAC work has considerable lead times on all of the equipment that we would be really looking to utilize and get into place.
However,
the turf is at the Old Plain campus?
Correct.
Or is it there too?
Old Plain.
Going back to my comments the other board meeting, though, I believe still to get that lead time, you need to do pre-purchasing, which may require money up front, though, as well. So as you guys plan that out, even though we may not be doing it to the following summer, you may need the money, though, still, because without pre-purchasing, you're not in the queue. Like, they don't even talk to you anymore.
Sure.
So I would assume that you've researched that, but I'm just encouraging you to if you haven't. The other, this would have been earmarked for capital projects, the money, right? Because I sometimes struggle internally every time I see a stove or a minivan or turf, and I hear about academic and curricular needs, and it kind of tears at me of where that happy balance is. I know we need all these things to operate. I totally get it, but my core charge is make sure to protect the education and growth of kids, and all this stuff is great, but it's also sometimes secondary to other needs that we have when we're talking kids who are failing and teams of 600 people and whatever. So if it's levied and earmarked anyway for capital projects, then that's discussion's done. But I always struggle when I see us approving things and that may not have that direct impact.
It wasn't on the list when we did the levy. Turf was not on the list.
Not on the bond proceeds, no.
Yeah.
One.
You're talking 2018,
about the big,
December,
you're talking about
correct.
The big
yeah.
refi.
About the $23 million facility.
Right, that's correct.
It was not on correct. The list at that time.
That's correct. I just want to make sure we were all talking about the, not gotcha. The last referendum, right. But the big bond
yeah.
fund.
I get it.
That's true. So this was.
Yeah, so I'd always put my trust in the administration to prioritize that, but it does, you know, there's an internal struggle, I think, probably from a few of us up here, so. Yeah, the vans, you've made a very compelling argument, but that being said, it's still.
I mean, I don't think any of these projects would stop us, at least from what I've seen of the finances of this whole project, from hiring whatever staff we might want.
Right. It's not an either or proposition.
Right. Not at this point. 10 years from now, it might be, but
yeah.
I think.
No, I agree.
Yeah.
That's
always been my baseline understanding, too.
Yeah.
So that helps me as well. Thank you.
When I mentioned the possibility of that Mike and I talked through maybe having someone come in and help us with a facility review, just overall, I saw a couple heads nod. Is that something that you'd be okay with us looking into some more?
Isn't that what our architects should be doing, though?
That's who we would talk to.
Right.
Are you asking? Yeah.
Should be doing for us, and I'm hoping that they would, like, they probably already know, but I would do we pay them extra for this, or
they have a
gotcha.
How
there's
we have a proposal now that was given to us. It's just under $80,000
just for them. Look at it
to go through the entire facility audit. Yeah,
be both schools.
We'll go back. So we're talking to them about that, and we would bring that to you for discussion.
I like that because I still feel like this is death by a thousand cuts. Every year we're talking about something that is an emergency that's $750,000, and it wasn't on a list 18 months ago. And suddenly it's on the list and has to be done. And we need to have visibility of how we're spending all this money across all these different areas, whether it's facilities, hiring, safety. Everybody's hand is in the cookie jar.
I think the press box is a good example of that. You know, the first time I gave you a list of, hey, here's the list that we had of facility needs, the press box was not on there. And then between the time that I gave you the list the first time and the second time, the press box got on there. Right. Yeah, I think you're right.
It's 300 grand.
Yeah, to spend $80,000 for someone to come and tell you what's wrong is a lot of money that...
Pretty standard. It's not bad. You're talking about professional architects developing a prioritized facility needs plan, which we don't have. Because if we had it, we'd know about the press box.
Buy cheap, get cheap.
Still a lot of money.
It is a lot.
I just look at it like, you know, in the community. Well, how is it that you have $80,000 now just to hire an architect? I mean, I wouldn't know how to answer that.
The answer is...
We don't fix something we didn't know about.
No different than people coming in and doing this health safety audit. They specialize in a certain area. They develop a nice ABC plan for you. I don't think that costs 80 grand, but...
Yeah, I mean, so if you think about it, the things that we've talked about doing that are kind of in this category are, we're talking right now about a facility audit. We've talked about an HVAC assessment. The cost of the HVAC assessment is about the cost of replacing two of our Univent units. So they can save us, they can identify areas where we don't need to spend that money. That would help. But it is significant dollars. We've talked about...
There's an offset, sorry to interrupt.
That's okay.
They're saving us money on this cost, but this cost is still being balanced off to paying that person, so we're still not saving.
Yeah, so
the break-even examples. If they can identify three spots where we might not need to replace, then it could pay for itself. But it might not pay for itself. They might come in and say, yep, you really do need to replace everything. On the agenda tonight, we've got a long-term financial analysis. So... some of this is probably to help me as well. As the new person coming in, I have less history with the district, and this helps me make sure that I'm getting a third-party perspective on everything, and so that our team can be validated in the work that they're doing. So some of this is me saying, hey, I think it would be helpful for our team if we got that third party. That's a possibility.
It still seems funny, because if we wouldn't have...
Questions you've got for us for facility projects? Okay, so it sounds like we're coming back in December with a couple bids. And then probably next month in December and probably in January, we'll, as we get some pricing on some of these things we'll talk about, we'll, even if it's not a bid, we'll come back to the board. So thank you.
Thank you. To the action items. First action item is the resolution authorizing the final aggregate tax levy for 2022. Any further questions or comments or questions?
No.
If not, I move to approve the resolution authorizing final aggregate tax levy for the year 2022, which includes the certificate of tax levy and separate resolutions for Illinois Municipal Retirement, Social Security, Special Education, Leasing, and CEDAL IMRF by the Board of Education of Warren Township High School District 121, Lake County, State of Illinois. Roll call.
Motion by Schultz, second by Martinez. Thank you. Mr. Carlson?
Aye, or yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes, motion carries.
Next up is an adoption of the resolution regarding gun violence. I know there's been some conversation about this on and off. I don't know if we want more conversation or if just go ahead and go with the motion.
I'm okay with the motion.
I'm fine.
Just move forward, and I move to approve, adopt the resolution regarding gun violence as presented.
Second.
Roll call.
And second by Anderson. Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes, motion carries.
Next up is the financial consulting agreement. Did you want to talk about this at all, Danny?
Yeah.
So I do think it's important. This one doesn't cost quite as much. This is a... It's only $6,000.
This is a small cookie.
Yeah, this is a small cookie.
I like the small cookie.
Probably I could, theoretically I can just do this on my own because it's such a small cookie. But I know that a priority for the school board with the referendum has been to try to be as transparent as possible, make sure that we're telling the right story. And so for not a lot of money, we can have an outside person come in and just make sure that support Mike and I as we put together the story that we're telling about the future of the school district financially. And so that'll be a really big help to Mike and I, and I think we'll validate some of that work, also provide the board and the community with just another perspective. So it's not a lot of money. It'll help us, and I think it'll help the board as we make decisions about where we want to prioritize our spending, the impact that that'll have in the future. So I appreciate any consideration there.
I assume you know these people.
I've never met these people. So PMA, we used to bring PMA in to do this. So I reached out to PMA about maybe considering doing that, and they don't do that service anymore. So they gave us a couple recommendations, and this was one of the recommendations.
That's fine. Good enough.
Anything else? I move to enter into a financial consulting agreement with Alignunate Inc. as presented.
Second.
Roll call.
Motion by Schultz and second by Drake. Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes, motion carries.
Next up is Dr. Engel. What's that?
We're going through the approval of the agreements regarding to the developer donations here. So this is something that we do every year with Lake County. This agreement provides a legal indemnification when they receive developer donations on our behalf and the district's behalf here. And we ask the board to approve each one of these each year. And it should be attached in your board docs there. Are there any questions on the developer donations? Thank you.
Nope.
I move to approve the agreements regarding the receipt of developer subdivision contributions and indemnifications in the event of a private agreement.
Second.
Roll call.
Motion by Schultz and second by Anderson. Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes, motion carries.
Yes.
Is there any protection here against a potential TIF?
As far as the development going through a TIF, that they would avoid a TIF is going to stand on its own. Absolutely. Okay. Yeah.
Minivans?
Minivans, yes. We went out to bid for minivans. We got back three bids. They're attached there for your review. One came back from Kenosha Toyota, Victory Toyota, and Tiles and Styles DBA Taza Supplies. The three bids came back, and the lowest apparent bidder at a base bid of $39,500 each. And again, this is over five of them, would be $197,500.
Leather seats and all the whistles?
You know it, no.
Well, for $39,000.
So that is...
Oh,
yeah.
$39,000 is not bad.
No.
It's cheap.
So that is...
It's crazy. Cars are crazy.
That I did reach out to 25 different dealerships, and I will tell you right now, within Cook County, Lake County, they're minimally going for $3,000 over sticker and as high as $10,000 over sticker.
You walk in the door.
Yeah. So they call it a regional adjustment. I'm not... This is... Yeah.
We call that a regional slap in the face.
Yeah. This is what came back. So this would allow the district to purchase five at this rate, hopefully try to get them in before June. We're not going to get five all at once. It's kind of a, as they come in, we would receive them.
So June's not when we need them? That's just the lead time to get them?
We could have one as early as 3 to 4 weeks, but typically the monthly allotment, you might get four or five, and we might get one of them for that month, and then the next month, maybe one. It might go 6 weeks. It's, yeah.
Questions?
Nope.
If not, I move to approve the Toyota Sienna minivan bid and award Kenosha Toyota as presented.
Second.
Roll call.
Motion by Schultz, second by Drake.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mr. Drake? Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes. Motion carries.
Thank you. Next up is our fiscal year 23 staffing plan update.
So there's two updates to this as far that we'd ask you to consider approving. One is the part-time communication specialist position we talked about previously, where we interviewed for those this week and are hoping to be able to offer that to someone in the coming days. So that's codified in there. Plus, we did receive our Title I carryover dollars. So on an annual basis, after the fiscal year is over, the state kind of says, okay, here's how much money was left over from this federal grant, and then they give everybody some new money. So for second semester, we're asking for positions in that would serve three English learner teaching positions and two bilingual aides. These positions would be focused on our English learner population.
Question. I know we talked about this. How often and how predictable is the Title I carryover dollars? And you know what my follow-up question is.
Yeah, so maybe... Oh, good. Thank you, friend.
So right now... our Title I is... We're still having kind of the impact of COVID in our title dollars. So our annual allotment that comes every year is usually between $290,000 and $320,000 comes to us every year. And right now we are at about $600,000 in our Title I grant because we still have the carryover from COVID where we weren't able to spend that money. So that money's rolled over year after year. But for the past 2 years, the state's, like normally Title I, you're limited to a 15% carryover limit. The state applied to the federal government for a universal waiver of that limit for the past two fiscal years. This year, we had to apply for that waiver of the 15% limit, carryover limit. So we got that waived for this year. But we're not allowed to then apply for that waiver again for another 3 years. So we have to spend that money this year because otherwise our carryover next year will be about maxed at about $60,000.
So Chris, is $60,000 about what it is on an annual basis usually?
Usually, but we get about 320 and usually at the end of the year, we're between 380 and 400 on a normal year.
So we can predict that we're going to get between $50,000 and $60,000 the next year?
Yes.
Usually.
So this is unusual for us to get a rollover
this large.
Like this large. And this is the second year because of the impacts of COVID. After this year, that rollover will be between $50,000 to $60,000.
Can we use it towards the architect?
No. We cannot.
You knew the answer to that.
I knew that. I know that.
Pick up the architect in the van.
So the reason why I'm asking.
We'll give them two vans.
The question that we had last week, I think we were talking, is if we know on average you're going to get about $60,000 per year, would it be easier to hire a person up front, knowing we're going to count on that money, wait rather than waiting till we have that money, then trying to hire a position?
We're only able to hire these positions through the grant because we have so much carryover. Normally, our normal grant budget for Title I, since it's so consistent, there are certain things that are exist in Title I, specifically every year, that pretty much chew up that grant amount. Like, we might have $50,000 to $60,000, like, in that grant annually, that we could then utilize for wherever we have some programmatic needs. But we can anticipate that in a consistent year. We know that in June, we know we're going to start with this. We can write this knowing that in December, we're going to be amending the grant once that title carryover comes through. So we can do that. It's just a little bit of a change in strategy. We kind of do that on a smaller scale, but we really, in the past, have tried to keep personnel out of the title grants because of the federal government next year, they could say, well, we're not going to release as much Title I money to the states as we have in the past, and all of a sudden we're down $60,000 on our allotment. So because we're talking about people and staff positions are important, I usually try to keep those out of the grants. But sometimes we can.
It's something to think about.
Yeah, absolutely.
Any other questions? If not, I move to approve the fiscal year 23 updated staffing plan as presented.
Second.
Roll call.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes. Motion carries.
Thank you, everyone.
Last up is disciplinary action recommendation for student 2023-4. I move to approve the disciplinary recommendation for student 2023-4.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes.
Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes. Motion carries.
That's it.
There's all the fun you get for today.
In that case, I move to adjourn the meeting.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Carlson? Mrs. Martinez?
Yes.
Mr. DeMonte?
Yes.
Mr. Drake?
Yes.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Schultz?
Yes.
Six yes. Motion carries.
Thanks, everyone, for your time tonight. Stay safe, stay healthy.
Top of the snow.